Welcome, everybody. My name is Emilio Garcia, and from Boundify, and we are here today with Tim Lowry, you know, SEO expert and good friend that is going to share with us today some insights on SEO basics. I'm really thrilled for this conversation that we are having, and I will let Tim introduce himself, talk a little about himself and what he does, and what we will be discussing today. And in the meantime, everybody can, if you want to, type in on the chat. I will be sharing some polls, and if you have any questions, please just type them in, and I will try to relay those questions to Tim so he can answer them timely. And finally, before moving into Tim, there's the handouts of the presentation. The slides of the presentation will be available right now. They are there and will be available on demand after this webinar ends. So without further ado, Tim, welcome.
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Emilio. I appreciate it. And thank you, everybody, for joining. It's great to be with you today. And as Emilio said, my expertise is in SEO. So I'm the founder of Tip Top Search and Marketing. We focus solely on SEO, helping our clients grow organically. For that, it's everything from the technical side of SEO, making sure that a site is structurally set up to win, through to developing content strategies and funnels to be able to increase their traffic and drive whatever the goals might be, whether it's getting leads, or we work with a lot of e-commerce, so ultimately to that final conversion of getting the sale. Today I would love for things to be as interactive as possible, just like Emilio said. So feel free to send questions in. Emilio, feel free to interrupt me, ask them as we go along. I'll be diving in and out of several different things, but the focus is going to be around keywords primarily today, how to build a strategy from that, but then also using that in the basics of SEO. So that would be for the various parts of the site and where to use them and within content and things like that. So Emilio, if you think we're good, I can jump into the deck. And
yes.
Again, just feel free to interrupt, ask questions. And again, I thank you for your time for joining us. So today, like I mentioned, we're going to be focusing a lot on keywords, but the three areas that I'm going to focus in on is keyword research. This would be finding those keywords that are relevant to your audience, to your site goals. And the question I would ask you is do you know what your audience is searching for? Do you know how they're finding you? What are those keywords at different stages of the funnel? So from the highest intent stage down to that very bottom part of the funnel of where we want to convert them. Do you know what those journeys look like as to the queries and the things that they're searching? Then we're going to take a look at on-site optimization. So this is then using those keywords that you've found and how to correctly apply them to the site in the way that works best for Googles, for searchers, and making sure that we're following best practices, but not overstuffing and other things like that. And then the final part will be then content optimization, which is really a big part of SEO, is that content side and doing it well. Obviously, there's the technical components, but if you have the right keyword funnels, then you want to know how to use those into building that content strategy. So we're going to take a look at that as well. And again, just ask questions as we go along. I look forward to this time together.
Thank you, Tim. One comment. Can you please share your presentation?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I can share my presentation. I'm already running on and...
Yeah, I noticed that. So
yeah. All right. Let's see. Share my screen. Where were you on that one, Emilio? You left me hanging. All right. Let me see. Can you guys see it now?
I'm sharing it, and so everybody should be seeing the presentation right now.
All right, perfect. Well, thankfully, we had only got one slide in. I hadn't like ran through like 50 different things, but so again, the three points: keyword research, on-site optimization, and content optimization. So the basic thing, just for anybody that is not familiar with SEO or is only starting to learn a little bit about it, would be, well, what is SEO? So it's the abbreviation for search engine optimization. And boiled down, it's basically the practice of influencing the search engine. So we're trying to achieve the best possible pages and content so that whenever Google or Bing or Yahoo or any of those bots crawl the site, they have a clear understanding and context of what it is. But we also want to be meeting the user's search intent. So it's creating pages that are not just Google friendly, because that's only going to win for a little while, but what is it that the user is looking for, and how do we deliver a ton of value so that we rank higher and that we get more traffic and better traffic to a site. So again, that would be a very basic overview of what SEO is, but we're going to dive in here to keyword research. And I think, Emilio, I'm not sure if you're going to fire the polls as we go along this.
I'm doing it right now.
This would be the good one for the first poll, which is how do you do your keyword research, if you do it? But if we take a look at what are keywords, and again, I'm trying to make this as broad as possible because I don't know who all's with us today and who all's seen this. So if you're not familiar with the concept of keywords, this is essentially what is being typed into the Google search bar. And I'll refer to Google a lot. Obviously, there is Yahoo and Bing and other search engines, but the reality is Google owns about 95-96% of all search. So really, whenever you're talking about SEO, you're doing what works for Google. And if it works for Google, then the others will most of the time follow suit with what you're doing there.
But I was going to ask you that, right? Is that I know that we are talking about search engines in general, but probably in your own experience and for the kind of clients that you have worked with, most of the work, I guess, is really focused on Google.
Yeah, primarily Google. I've had once or twice I've had anomalies where Bing might win specific pages where it's stronger for things. And what I usually find is that it's audience-based, that Bing has, let's just say, like a more seasoned or an older audience. So people that buy a PC and they out of the box use Microsoft Edge with Bing on it. So usually it's people that aren't as search savvy. They're not making as deep a query. And that would kind of qualify some of the Bing. But Bing is improving. But again, if you satisfy Google, you will find that you most likely satisfy a good ranking or a good positioning on any of the other search engines that are out there. But again, if we go back to keywords, this is the query that people are typing in to the search bar. So most of the time you'll hear it called keywords. Google calls it queries whenever you're using Search Console. It can be anything from a singular word through to a complex sentence, and that's where you start having those very long tail, bottom of the funnel type pages starting to surface. As I think around most businesses and most companies that I work with, and probably for your own business, you're going to have two different types of keywords. You have on one side what I would say is your product or your service type keywords. So in the case of this one, we're kind of product focused versus service being, you know, lawn care or something like that. So on the product side, we have AutoZone here, and I'm going to use my mouse rather than my finger because you obviously can't see where I'm pointing on my screen. Have a bad habit of doing that on virtual calls at times, but we have our keyword up here. So as a query, we have replacement headlight lens, and the volume for that using the tool I have here shows about 1,300 people per month search for this. First thing you're going to see is we have an ad feed here of images, then we have a traditional ad, and then we have our first organic listing on the page here being AutoZone. So for your company or for, you know, whatever it is that you're representing today, you need to be thinking about what are those commercial intent keywords that somebody that wants to purchase something or hire you to do a service, what are those keywords? And that's going to be bucket one of keywords is going to be focusing around those commercial product service intent type queries. Then your second bucket of keywords is going to be your content keywords. So keeping with that similar thinking here on headlight lenses, you could find that one of your customer perhaps does something like how to replace a headlight. So this is where we're shifting from meeting them on a commercial intent to meeting them either before they make that decision on what product they're going to purchase. They might be looking to how to change it and whether or not they're capable of doing that themselves, or if it's something that they need to hire somebody, or it may be somebody's already made the purchase. So you need to think about how are we going to structure that content and what are those keywords, those things that people ask. So again, we have our search up here. It shows that we get about 1,900 people a month that search for this. Then you have what is called a featured snippet. So this is now officially organic one whenever that shows on a result page. Then we have our people also ask. Then we can see in this one, we have then some of the knowledge cards here. So they're taking you to YouTube. So we've got video cards. Then we have organic one, organic two. But we can see that AutoZone, who is ranking for the headlight lens replacement, is also ranking content. So for them, they're meeting the user now on two different ways that they may potentially be searching for something. And as a brand, it's so important to not just always be meeting somebody on the commercial intent. You want to be able to meet them as they take the different steps of their journey. And if they start seeing your brand appear in search results and they start reading your content, it builds more trust with that person as they start to move towards that commercial intent stage, whenever they're going to make a purchase or whenever they're going to sign up for your product or become a lead, whatever that might look like for your business.
I have a question for you here, Tim.
Yes, please, Amelia.
Because this is a very interesting concept that you're presenting. I think most people will be familiar with the idea of keywords, of course, you're right. And maybe they will get some confusion between the ads and the organic result. But once you have settled on that, one question that I have is most people request your help with the commercial side of the organic result for their business, or more for the educational portion. And the second question would be, and it doesn't matter if they're as one or the other, what is the way that you usually recommend, right? Where do you start those conflicting efforts, I guess?
Obviously, many times people are very much revenue driven whenever they're thinking about getting people to their site. And that's fine and that's good. We want to have traffic that converts. But at the same time, if you focus purely on that bottom of the funnel or on the commercial side, it's fine if you rank those pages, but if people aren't familiar with the brand, if you're not a household and being in e-commerce, a lot of times, I could go up to bat against something like a Home Depot or a Lowe's, let's say, and those are very trusted brands. So if you're not known and you show, as position two or three among those, people may be more inclined to click on the brand they're familiar with. Whereas if you've proven yourself with good content and other things prior to the person making that transition to making the purchase, there's going to already be some trust established around your brand. So usually the way I present it or how I would connect with a client on this is, it's like, yes, we want to optimize and fix those pages that need to be fixed for the commercial intent side of it, but we want to build out content that helps those pages not only rank better, but also builds out your funnel at different stages of the journey. And I'll dive into this in a little bit. We use somewhat of a modified version of like a pillar and cluster type situation, where if anybody's familiar with HubSpot, you have your pillar page and you have your cluster posts. We kind of flip the model to where we create the pillars as a commercial intent page. So that could be for e-commerce, that could be a category page. For a SaaS company, that could be your product demo page or something like that. But then we build the clusters all around that subject. And I'll dive into that a little bit more as we move through this. I'll kind of explain that process a little bit better. But does that hit on what you're looking for, Emilio?
It does. And I love it. And I agree completely with you, right? I guess it's so easy to say, well, I want to narrow it down on the bottom. But at the same time, that's, I think, is the toughest area, is where you are more restricted in terms of volume, right? Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, as you said, you have to build that trust. You have to build that effect of this brand has helped me in the past. Now mm-hmm. I can trust and look at their commercial products or services available. So yeah, I completely agree. And thank you. Thank you for sharing this.
Yeah, certainly. And there is, there's a term that's out there where it's called surround sound SEO. And that would be where you're basically trying to be everywhere that your potential customer would be. So that moves from even just those on-site SEO things of where you're trying to get your pages to rank, but also off-site where you're getting into guides and best-offs. So that way, whenever people are hitting all the different variations of how they search for something, you're showing in those. So we'll dive into that a little bit here as well. It's just like, here's another way to think around your SEO strategy and how you use keywords and knowing which keywords to use. But with that said, let's dive into the keyword portion here, because obviously it's great to take a look at an example, but it's always good to know how to actually get there. So whenever you're wanting to create your keyword list or how to find them, you're going to want to take a look in a few different areas. And these are usually the places that I start with. The first one being Google searches. Seems very simplistic, but you can learn so much just by making a search and seeing what Google returns as the result page. Because in your mind, you might have the best keyword, but when you make that search, you find that the intent of the result page does not match what you thought. And that makes it a bad keyword, even if you think the volume's great and your customers are going to be there. If Google says otherwise, then you're targeting the wrong results. The next one would be then competitive. So this one, again, we can tell by the result page, if we were targeting this, this is very much a commercial intent page. We are ad heavy to the top, we're ad heavy to the side, and we start taking a look then at the result pages. And we have Amazon, we have Uplift. We go into a little bit of content, but again, as I look at who is showing in there, you have to think, am I going to be able to compete against New York Times, CNET, Wirecutter? And if your brand is not strong enough, then you don't want to go after a big term like this, because this is going to just, it's going to eat you up. You're not going to be able to compete. So again, you have to think realistically around what you can compete with. And then we also move into, you know, popular products. And again, we have more commercial intent pages throughout this. So it's not really till we get to the bottom of the page, we see one more content piece here. But then something to keep in mind is you have standing desks as the keyword that you're going to, but you might want to take a look at something like stand-up desks. How does that look? The first thing that I notice is that the volume drops down drastically. So we go from 110,000 searches a month to 6,400 a month. We're still staying in the commercial intent, but it's not going to be perhaps as difficult to win as trying to go after the absolute biggest term. And that's a battle with SEO constantly, is knowing, can I win the big term or is it too competitive? And if it's too competitive, then you're wasting a lot of energy going after something that if you're outside of the first page, you're not going to get traffic. So there's no point trying to get something if you can't rank it. Whereas if you can get in the top, three, top five for something with lesser volume, you're going to probably get more clicks just because you rank better. So don't always kind of, I guess, get starstruck by like the big volume keywords. As good as they are, you have to know whether or not you can actually win that keyword. And if you can't win it now, you make that your goal, that over, 12 months, 24 months, you build up enough strength on your domain and enough basically track record for your page and everything else to where you can kind of flip it into that bigger term to try and win that later. But if it's your first time to push that page live, that could be really competitive and really hard to try and get. A different example here, and this kind of falls into that surround sound SEO that I was talking about, which would be coffee subscriptions. So if you're a brand and you roast your own coffee and you have subscriptions that you sell from your site, you would naturally think, well, I want to make my optimization efforts towards winning the search for coffee subscription. But if we take a look here,
very crowded place.
It's very crowded, but the people that are paying for ads, they're curated boxes, except for Pete's down here, which is a national brand. Like Beanbox, Atlas, Drink Trade, those are all basically, they curate different coffees and send you a different one each month. Mm. So you're competing against curators. And then once you go down into this page, you then start to see that you've got a curator, another curator, and then you go into lots of blog posts, 16 best, 10 of the best, 9 of the best. So if you were looking at a strategy and this was your company that you're trying to do this for, what you would say to yourself is, okay, well, if I want to be in front of all of my customers, I want to have my coffee sold through Drink Trade. So how do I get into their boxes, or how do I become a coffee that they carry? Then you want to start outreaching the likes of Roasty, Forbes, Vogue, and saying to them, hey, not sure when you're updating your content, but we would love to be included or considered for your next one, and getting samples to them. And again, people that are at that top of the funnel stage of trying to find what is the best coffee subscription to do, they're going to be reading these contents. So if your content, or I should say your product, is showing in Forbes and Vogue, and then they go over to Drink Trade and they see you there, they might experience your brand through one of those channels first, but if they like it, they might come back direct later. So again, looking at the result page tells you a lot about how you need to position essentially your content, your keyword, your efforts, your optimization. Is it on your site? Or in this case, are you doing offsite optimization for your brand? And again, that's a way of thinking around your keywords as part one of, you know, basically any kind of successful keyword research. It's knowing the result page you're going to show on. The second method that I look at is Google Search Console. I'm guessing
that I was going to tell you something here that I loved how you presented that contrast, because for me, something that is very interesting is that when you have keywords like those, right, like coffee yeah. subscriptions, where the intent from the user is not clear for the person that is doing the research, yeah. there's nothing like going to the search result, as you're saying, right? Because mm-hmm. for me, pretty much what Google is doing here for you is translating the most popular intent.
Yeah. Right?
The results kind of like convey the idea that even when they are not saying it, most people that is typing in coffee subscription only, they are in the lookout of recommendations for mm-hmm. the test, you, right? Because that's what is being served on the SERP.
Yeah.
And that's something valuable, because as you were saying, maybe you shift the strategy and say, maybe I don't want to rank here directly. I want to move to the second tier and maybe just being enlisted by these companies.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Yeah, that's so true. And again, just it's one of those obvious ones, but so many times gets overlooked. And it's just look at what Google's telling you, because they're going to tell you what the user's expectation is for that type of query. And if you're trying to fit, you know, a round result into a square hole, you're not going to show up. You have to match what the intent is for the query.
Yes.
The next one, which I'm assuming most people that are listening probably are familiar with this, but if not, Google Search Console. This is a tool in the Google Suite. So just like Google Analytics, it tells you all of your different traffic sources and pages and all that information. Google Search Console is focused solely on the organic side of things. And this is going to tell you on the front end as to what Google is showing your site for and how many clicks, impressions, average position, things like that. So if you have Google Search Console on your site, you're going to start learning for, you know, well, what are they actually showing me for? And worst case scenario, you look at it and realize they're really not showing me for what I want to show for. Best case scenario, you start seeing keywords that they're showing you for, and maybe you see some really good ones in there, and you're maybe position 8, 10, 15. And if you look at those are opportunities of like, okay, well, how do I move this from an average position of 15 down to, you know, top 3, top 5? So you can really dial in. It might be that you're not targeting the keyword in the right way, or you're just a little bit thin on the content or what you need to achieve in that page. So look at Google Search Console. And again, you're going to have your queries and how people are looking for you. And for this one, we have several really good terms and we get great traffic off that. The next one that I would mention then is taking a look at competitors. So we're going to grab Sticker Mule here. And this will tie into an example that I'm going to share with you. But if you're a labeling company and you create coffee labels, we can see here as we look at their page, we have different terminology. And this might be a good one for the second poll, which would be, you know, are you familiar with LSI? So latent semantic indexing is the long term for it. And also related keywords is another way to refer to it. But a lot of times you'll hear people talking about LSI when they're talking about their on-page copy. So as we look at coffee, our Sticker Mule here, we have coffee labels, our H1. This is the big keyword that they're going after on the page. But then we can see custom coffee labels. We see coffee bags. So we're starting to go into these related keyword terms that they're going to use. We can also see that they're starting to introduce some finishes to the label as we go down the page. You know, we're still using the terms labels worthy of excellent coffee, but we're not matching exact phrases. And that's one of the things I'm just going to pause for a second and mention. Like if you jump back 5 years ago to keyword usage, even probably more than that, let's say about 8 years ago, keyword stuffing was a big thing because that was before Google was as smart as it is now. So people would think the more that I use coffee labels throughout the page, you know, the better the odds are that I'm going to rank for that term because I've stuffed it in 100 times on my page. Google now does not want that. They want you to obviously use a well-targeted keyword because that helps them understand the context of the page. But then you start moving into natural language search. They recently done an update called BERT, which is very much natural language focused. And then you have your LSI, which is those related keywords. So if you're talking about coffee labels, then you want to start talking about coffee bags. You might want to talk about coffee bottles. You want to talk about roasting. You want to talk about anything that would be relevant to that subject for a user to be able to resonate with it. So again, we can see some matches of coffee labels. And then we have, you know, coffee roll labels. So they're introducing another variation of how their product would be. But we have then terms for labels like full color. And then, you know, adding to your bags. So we can see throughout the page, they've got various uses of the coffee label term. And then of course we go down and we see some social metrics in here of people giving reviews, but within those we'll find that people are also commenting on specific terms that also help to boost the ranking of that page. So looking at your competitor's page is going to help influence your decision as to how you optimize your page, or again, are you going to be able to beat them, or do you need to do a variation off that to try and win? But it's great to learn from them. And then the final way to research your keywords is using a keyword tool. So you've probably
going to interrupt you, Tim, here. Yes. We got the result from the poll, and yeah, 100% of people is not familiar with LSI, right?
Okay.
Thank you for sharing that. And we have a question here. Yeah. Let me show it. Alfredo asks, Tim, I see on your screen volume and CPC and competition right below the Google search field, but I don't see that on my own. Which brand?
So that's what I'm going to go to now, Alfredo. I have a secret tool for you here. So like every good content creator, SEO, PPC person, tools are one of the ways that you are basically assisted in knowing what to target or go after. So there's a lot of different tools for doing your keyword research. There is, you know, Moz, there's SEMrush, there's Ahrefs. But I would say, you know, for people that just want quick answers in the result page, I don't think you can beat keywords everywhere. And that's what this tool is. It's a plugin that goes in Chrome. You basically buy credits. So for about $10, you get 100,000 credits. And a credit is applied for each keyword that is shown on the page. But it still will last a relatively long time. And for like $100, you can buy 10 million credits or something like that. Like it's not an expensive tool for the value that it gives. But what you will find is that it overlays the result page. So that's where you're getting this volume. You're seeing the cost per click. Then we see related keywords. So if I'm doing stand-up desk, well, maybe I need to consider adding some of these keywords into the copy that I use on that page. So sit stand desk, we can see that there's, you know, great volume for that. Stand-up desk converter. As we move down, we can see what other people search for. So it's starting to bring in different search queries that people make whenever they're searching around this, which is, again, is really helpful because that's going to aid your research because you're going to want to start looking into these different queries and seeing what the result page is, because you may find there's just a little gap somewhere that you can slide in and win way better. So like this adjustable standing desk converter, it's kind of a mouthful, but if you do that as a target, like a secondary target in your content or on your on page, that could be way more winnable than trying to go after stand-up desks. So you might get an early win with that and then eventually win stand-up desks. So you want to use tools that help to influence what you're doing. And again, this one's called Keywords Everywhere, and it's a great tool. I can't give it enough hype because I literally use it all day, every day for pretty much everything that I'm doing. It just, it really helps to inform a lot of decisions, and I found some really good insights through using this.
Awesome. Sorry, that was me.
No worries. I was looking at my phone. I'm like, I think I have mine in silence. So once you've got your keywords, then the next thing that you're going to do is you're going to use them properly on your site. And we hit on that a little bit with the sticker mule page, but we're going to talk about the best places and how to use them. And some of you may be like, I'm already aware of this. And if so, stick with me. You might get some insights as we're thinking about this. But on your page, you have obviously your title and your meta description. Those are not seen outside of the result page. So that is purely you optimizing for what the user is going to see, but it influences Google. Your title and your meta description, your goal with them is to be as relevant as possible with the title and having the keyword in that. But then your meta description, think of that like ad copy. How do you draw the click? How do you stand apart? How do you create this great introduction and then have some kind of call to action towards the latter part of that meta description? And that's going to increase your click-through rate. Your keyword used in the URL, in your heading tags, you want to appropriately use it. Then on your on-page copy, images, and then of course reviews, because Google more and more leans on social proof as to whether people actually like your product. So for the title and meta description, let's do an example here. If you're using a WordPress site, this is for a client of mine that happens to sell labels as one of their products, and they do labels for coffee products. So for them, we looked at the results, we looked at the different things and basically targeted, well, what would be most winnable for us? Where can we rank highest initially and what can we move towards? So custom coffee labels is our primary keyword that we're going for, but we also are working in coffee bag labels here because we saw that several of the people, if we go down through the result page, they kind of have a double intent as to how they optimize title tags. So it worked, but if it's not being done in the result that you're going after, you don't want to stick out like a sore thumb by using that strategy. So you want to decide how best to approach that. But our title here, we're simply using the variations of the keywords in that. We're not doing exact matches, so it's not stuffing keywords or anything like that. And then we have just a nice description here of, you know, favorite with independent roasters. We've got coffee labels, bags, boxes, cold brew, bottles. And then our basically text that we want to get people hooked in on is that we have no minimums and fast turnaround. And as we take a look over at the result here, this is where it's going to show up for the users. And we can see Google is kind of highlighting, you know, the keywords. And again, we don't have an exact match for custom coffee labels in our meta description. Google's smart enough to know if we say coffee labels or custom coffee labels, those kind of match together. But if we look at the page, I'll kind of give you a breakdown of how we use the language on that. And again, we have a lot of variations. So this is where that LSI comes in, and there's a tool out there. I think it's basically just called LSI tool. But if you Google that up, you'll find that there's several tools that exist, like keyword tools, where you would put in your seed keywords. So you could put in running shoes for the sake of it, and it's going to start bringing up all of the related terms that you might want to include. So it may be that, you know, you want to include, you know, lightweight, fast, red. There may be various things that just people naturally gravitate towards. And if you can work those into your copy, then that's going to help you immensely. So as we look at our page, again, we have our H1. So your H1, I want you to think of that as the title of your book. So that is the most important tag on the page, and there should only be one H1. So always double check that, because sometimes you might have a WordPress site or some other one, and by default, all of the headlines, stylus and H1, shouldn't happen, but I have seen it, or people write a blog post and they think more stylistically about how they use their header tags rather than thinking about them from an importance of ranking. So you want to have a semantic structure to your page. So you have your H1, your H2 then is a chapter within your book, and then an H3 would be like a subsection within that H2. So you want to have that nice semantic ordering as you go down through the page. But in this page, we have custom coffee labels. We've got roasters, custom printed coffee label. We've got variation within there. We've got coffee beans, bags. So we have a lot of related terms that makes this make sense to the user and resonate with them. As you scroll down the page, we have another little block of copy here. Since putting this screenshot in, we've actually added a video into the page now, which is kind of a customer testimonial that goes along with it. So that adds a little bit more value. But again, we're talking about how to apply the product, what it can be used on, types of materials. So we're creating the keywords, but we're also tying in things that are relevant to the use and the feel and what the product can be used on. And those are things that Google starts looking for. They don't want just somebody that says, I make a coffee label and here's my purchase or my checkout button. You need to inform the users that are going down through your page. Then we've introduced reviews, and these scroll sideways, and that gives us, again, a lot of good social proof on the page. And then we have an FAQ section to the bottom, which has a drop down, and that gives lots more answers to anything that people would be looking for in and around how to label coffee bags. If they have cold brew bottles, they need to have, you know, considerations then if it's going to be in a cool place or a fridge or if there's going to be moisture. So again, we're thinking around all of the different ways that we can answer what a user might want or have to try and make this a really good converting page.
I'm going to interrupt you because I'm thrilled to see, and I would love to hear your opinion on this. Mm-hmm. I'm looking, for example, at the best practices on how do you propose the headline or the H1, right? And the title, yeah. The title in this case, and the meta description. And I can see paid and SEO or paid and organic converging on best practices on how do you present the information and then the landing page, right? For example, yeah. Using that pipeline between the terms on the title is something that on the ad, on the paid side happens naturally between the headlines that you set up on an ad. And also, as you were saying, the meta description is ideally has to have a call to action, which is for ads descriptions, definitely something that is worth following. Yeah. And I know they're different, but for example, these days I can see a lot of you know, website pages that follow a lot of the, you know, definitions or expectations of a landing page, even when they are not truly landing pages.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, for choosing what's going to go in your H1 and what's going to go, you know, in your title, you want to be thinking about the type of page and also, again, letting your competition somewhat guide you on how to do that. You know, so if you have e-commerce intent type pages, so whether it's, you know, B2C e-commerce or B2B e-commerce, which this site is kind of like a B2B e-commerce, it's for business. Those commercial intent queries are very specific as to, you know, I want coffee labels or I want custom coffee labels. So just having a very clear and to the point H1 is better than having something that's dressed up a little bit more. But if you're doing, you know, like a SaaS company, or if you have something that's, you know, not as commercially intent, where it's more of a service or a software or a product or something like that, you can make it more of a traditional headline. But I would say that, you know, your H1, you want to have that keyword ideally in there, because again, you're informing Google. The problem is sometimes if you go along that line of like, well, I want our page to be, you know, really heavily visual, and I want it to be very simplistic in our messaging and things like that. That is fine, except for the fact that Google still relies on some of these things. Keyword research, you know, it's an old SEO thing, but it's something that is still so important. And if it's not done right, or if it's overlooked, or if it's, you know, kind of a half-baked effort, then you're not going to get the results that you anticipated. So you need to really think around that and how to apply that into those areas. And the areas that are important are your H1, your title, and then making sure you have some matches within the copy, but more so those related invariants of it. The LSI versions are going to be equally as important. Tools like SEMrush, you can use their on-page optimization tool that reviews that. And if you have your competitors in there, it'll tell you how you stack up. So let's say your competitor uses 20 different variations, but you found that you're using, you know, 30 different variations, and everybody else is less than the competitor, then you're probably on the overstuffed side of things. So you want to make sure that you're within a very similar parameter to the pages that are currently ranking, and that you're not, you know, being too heavy-handed on your usage of it throughout that. But the title and the H1 are definitely still very important places to use that, and as natural as possible. That's going to be the big emphasis. Like, things have to be done natural now.
You have to solve for the user, right? At the end of the day,
for the user. But if it's used naturally, and it's also clear, a user's not going to mind if they hit a page and the H1 very clearly tells them that this page is custom coffee labels. Like, that's to the point. We don't need to make it, you know, the most wonderfully sticky coffee labels in the universe. That's a fun headline for the sake of it, but it doesn't do anything different for us. It probably wastes space and time for the user to get the context of the page. So you want to just think around that. Where you can get creative is on your headlines with your content, and within your content. And that's kind of the last part I'll dive into. Again, I want to respect the time of the presentation here. And it's one of those things, like, this topic, you can go for hours on so many different ways, and we could drill really deep into different parts, but this is kind of your overarching view of, like, we've got our keywords and how are we going to use them between our on-page strategy, our off-page strategy, and then now with our content strategy. So we kind of reflect back on, we had our product type keywords, and now we're thinking about our content keywords. And I think our final poll, I think Amelia was the one on, you know, who's familiar with, you know, using pillars and clusters. And this is where I turn that pillar cluster model around a little bit, of where I start taking commercial intent pages. So I'm not taking a long 6,000 word pillar page of content, which would be that traditional HubSpot model. I'm taking, in the case of this one, it's going to be for a company, and one of their commercial pages is for water softeners. But we want to build all the content around water softeners, is, you know, how to use it, when to buy it, where to, you know, apply it, what to put it in, which country, like which parts of the country need that more. And you start building that content and around that, but it all links back and it all passes the equity into our collection page or our category page that we want to rank high for the commercial intent, but we also get really good warm traffic from the content. And falling into your side of things, Emilio, that gives them a lot of traffic to start retargeting because we have that high and mid funnel traffic on the content side.
Yeah, I'm very excited about you talking about this topic, you know, the flipping the model a little bit on the topic cluster, because I agree with you. As you know, I have personally tried with some of our clients the, you know, traditional HubSpot topic cluster model, and it lacks on the, you know, I think it's great for big companies. Mm-hmm. When you want to dominate a general topic on with the cluster, you are sending a person to a pillar page and then you are offering something in exchange, an ebook, and then you follow up on lead nurturing, I think it's great. But for most clients or for most companies, it's a very long effort because I agree with you that, you know, you want to be on the middle, top of the funnel, but once you get some people there, you want to move not as quickly, but in a good pace into the bottom. And when you put the pillar there, then you leave on the user to follow up, maybe with lead nurturing, and you know, the move into some value is not that easy. So I love this idea because it really, and especially with all that is happening on ungated content and not necessarily having people in databases anymore. Retargeting can do that. And you can just explain your offer right away. And if it's not the right time, people will come back on their own time, right? And you can be present through remarketing. And that way you simplify a little bit the things for when it doesn't make sense to build such a complex model.
Yeah, agreed. And also just, you know, content is an investment in and of itself. And once you, you know, if you create a pillar page and you want to do 10 pieces of content around that, you know, that can become a huge investment because the pillar page is just so deep and so researched, and it may or may not work. Whereas if you're targeting your pillar is, you know, your main product or your main category or whatever that might be, you know, you're not creating the wheel there. You've got a converting page because that's what the page is designed for, and you're just doing your effort to essentially build that up and generate links and equity to that page. So I found that this is a good strategy, and it's, like I said, it's a little bit of a hybrid of what they might suggest there, but when tested in the wild, I know this works. So it's something I'm kind of sticking with. But again, you have your content keywords. When you're creating that content, you also want to think around those answer boxes in the PAA. So that would be when you make a query, your answer box is that feature at the top of the page where Google's giving you that rich answer in a featured box or a featured snippet. PAAs are people also ask. So if there's PAAs in the queries that you're doing, those start to become long tail keywords. So again, this is where that, you know, researching the result page, so researching the SERPs and seeing life in some way, they are looking for your content to reflect that way. So essentially, if there's an exchange of money anywhere in the process, they want it to be expert, authoritativeness, and trustworthy.
Tim, do you hear me?
Yes.
I think the feed drop again from you. It's weird because for a little second, you we lost you, and then you get back and I can see you, but the rest can't.
Am I back?
It's back. It's back. Okay. You're back. Sorry about that.
All right. So I was talking about Google's acronym there of EAT, expertise, authoritativeness, trustworthiness, and your on-page should reflect that. But then you also want to think further into optimization. So things like video, you know, that's non-traditional keyword, but if you look at a result page and the whole top feed of that is videos, then you want to be represented in that. So I mentioned for a client here, so this is an example. So we look at water softener, which is, you know, a big keyword, but within water softener, there's a huge amount. If you keep clicking the people also ask, we start getting some really rich questions that come from that around cost, what is best, how does it work, can you drink it? Then as we start looking at the, you know, content type queries. So how does a water softener work? Then we see, okay, well, there's videos in this result. And then we have a whole lot more PAAs. And then we have the content that we're going to look at, my client's piece here. So what is a water softener and how does it work? So again, you want to do that SERP analysis and look at what is coming up in the different types of queries. So from the commercial side all the way through to the content side. So I know we're down to the last few minutes, so I'm going to just give a quick overview. Whenever I talk about, using EAT for expertise, authoritativeness, trustworthiness, this is where we have essentially built this pillar around water softeners, which they sell on their site, or I should say cluster, and this links back to it. It also links back to several other ones. So we've got a really good hub and spoke model going on in this site. But we've got a nice clear title here. We've got our, seed keyword of water softener, but we're answering what is it, how does it work? As you go through it, the first thing you get is a video. If you can do video content, that's a great investment. We actually rank this video in several result pages. But it also, if somebody clicks this to start it, that fires a tag and Google knows that within seconds of being on the page, we have engagement on the page, which then helps reduce our bounce rate. And then this is where I really want to point out, like when you're creating content, a lot of times you build nice intros and they're maybe, kind of fun or perhaps a little bit fluffy, just to kind of tease somebody in. Google doesn't mind it, but they don't love it. What Google loves is whenever you answer the question right away, and this is what wins answer boxes, and the answer boxes ultimately drive more traffic because they have now replaced position one. So the post is on what is a water softener. So straight away, we're not wasting time. We're telling people what it is, what it does. Then we go into a more in-depth response here, which is, again, answering that. We're linking to additional resources. But as we go down, we're going into all of the different PAAs that exist out there. So how do they work? What are the components of it? And we give very clear explanations. We've got great illustrations and examples that go along with it. And I'm just going to scroll down just quickly. So this is very long form, but we have an opportunity where if somebody wants to convert on the page, they can. What do they remove? Does it remove iron? Is it safe to drink? What does it look like? Linking to then additional, as we talk about reverse osmosis, we have another huge guide that we've done on that. So again, this is very long form. It's probably about 4,000 words or thereabouts. So we have several posts that we've created like this, which you may be thinking like, well, this is almost like a pillar in and of itself, but this is what it takes in this space to do authoritative expert content. And it is an investment, but the reason that we go into deep content like this is it really returns. And I'm just going to show this to you because again, tracking your keywords and knowing what they do for you is so important, but also justifying the investment is important. So for this one piece of content, we rank almost 900 keywords. It brings in about 9,000 visits per month to the site. And if you were to pay that traffic in, so if you're doing Google Ads, it's going to cost you about $32,000 a month to pay that traffic into the site. And if you think about building content like this around your high value commercial intent keywords, and in their case, if we've got 30, 40 pieces that are working like this, that starts to really change the landscape of your website to where you're all of a sudden getting hundreds of thousands of views per month into your site that's coming through content that you would have to pay a lot for if you're doing Google Ads, but you can retarget those. But it's also helping to leverage your main commercial intent keywords, because any links that we acquire to this page all points back into our collection or our category page, as you might be familiar with. So it's helping that commercial intent page get stronger, but at the same time, we're answering a lot of questions on the front end of the journey for the user. So that would be kind of tying the whole thing together of like, we've optimized our, our commercial intent, our products page, but now we're doing content that goes alongside that and really supports the effort.
I wanted to say that, definitely you have to invest in the SEO so you can save those $30,000. But if for any reason you are investing that amount already, I would like to know.
Yeah. Yeah, Amelia would like to work with you.
That's amazing.
But yeah, if there's any questions, I know we covered a lot of ground and I apologize for the cutting in and out, but I'm happy to answer anything I can or help anybody out, or, you know, feel free to reach out to me on LinkedIn and I'll, you know, connect with you on questions, maybe specific to your sites as well.
Fantastic. Tim, thank you very much. And I apologize for the technical difficulties. I, as I was telling Laura in the previous session, it's clear that even when I love the, you know, the interface overall, the stability of it is not that as great as I would expect. So probably I'm going to test out something different for the next session. However, for everybody that is watching right now and on the future, thank you for getting here. Tim, thank you for sharing all this knowledge with us. All the links from the presentation will be available. And as you can see, Tim is, you know, if you are going to explore anything related to SEO, you are going to be in the best hands. So I appreciate it, Tim, for the time, for everybody's time. And I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. And thank you again, everybody, for joining. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
Bye.